This is a production of Cornell University.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for being here. For most of this talk, I will be focusing on the living mulch trials that we conducted in tomato at our vegetable research farm in Freeville. But alongside those tomato plots, we also conducted the soil cover crop trials. The intention of the soil cover crop trials, it did not have any cash crop. And the intention there was to evaluate more herbicide treatments and also to use herbicides that are not registered for use in tomato. However, because it's very similar to the tomato trials, I will not be discussing that today. In the summer and fall of 2016, we also conducted greenhouse experiments at the Gudaman greenhouses. And this was to look at potential release of nitrogen from the roots of living mulches under herbicide stress from chemical stress from herbicide applications. And that also, we did not see any evidence of nitrate release, and so I won't be talking about that as well. But I will be talking about my master's project, which was the first series of living mulch trials that we conducted in the cotton systems in central India in 2012 and 2013, for which, in an outstanding state of affairs, I would leave just in time for an Indian summer and be back just in time for the winter here. So since all of these experiments are based on living mulches, just a quick introduction on what living mulches are and their benefits. So living mulches are essentially cover crops or companion crops that are grown alongside the cash crop. And typically, they don't have any economic value. And their primary purpose is for soil conservation. They help to cover the soil surface, especially between the interval spaces of the crop, really quickly before the onset of the rains. And this helps to minimize soil displacement by raindrops or wind. They also help to reduce surface runoff and thereby the movement of pesticides and fertilizers off the field. Living mulches are also an excellent way to increase the resource use efficiency of the agroecosystem and thereby produce more biomass and organic matter. Living mulches, vigorous stands of living mulches can also be useful in removing water quickly in clay soils that are prone to water stagnation. One other very interesting and important outcome of living mulches is that the presence of living mulches make interrow cultivation during the season very difficult. And so the adoption of a living mulch system is an excellent deterrent to excessive tillage. In terms of weed suppression, the presence of living mulches reduces the diurnal fluctuations of light and temperature in the soil, which are very important triggers for weed seed germination, so you have less weed pressure during the season. And during the season, besides the direct competition with the weeds, by providing a more competitive environment in the interrow space, when weeds experience this increased competition in the interrow space, they tend to allocate less resources towards production of seeds, and this again is beneficial. So with that, the first set of trials that we conducted in cotton. So this was conducted in the central region of India, which is the cotton belt. And this is the warmest region in India, and this is very conducive for cotton cultivation, along with the black clay verdisol soils, which is also very conducive for cotton cultivation. And in many ways, the topography and also the climate is very similar to the southwestern region of the United States. So each year, this was conducted in 2012 and 2013. And each year, we had four different sites. One at the agronomy research farm at the local agricultural university, and three of them were on-farm trials on private growers' fields. So the grower fields were 2 to 3 miles from each other, and they were all about 15 miles from the research farm. At each site, we tested five different species of living mulches, along with one control, which was hand-weeded and weed-free. The cotton was planted in June. It was seeded in a row spacing of 5 feet, and between two rows of cotton, we had 3 to 4 rows of living mulches. These were the different treatments that we tested at the different sites in different years. Glyrocedia and lab, they were tested only during the second year because they were used as replacements for two other species that did not emerge at all in year one. So we discarded those and replaced them with Glyrocedia and lab. And we also lost two sites during year one because the grower ended up in prison. And so, but during the second year, we had all the living mulch species and all the sites. And so that was good. These were the different species of living mulches that we used, and all of them, except the sorghum Sudan grass, they were legumes. So we had Cespania, we had Glyphosedia, sorghum Sudan grass, lab, and sunhem. And lab, also known as dolichos bean, is an edible bean. So we tested lab as a marketable vegetable intercrop and not as a true living mulch. So we did not collect biomass or any other data from it. So we did not use any herbicides pre or post-emergent in these trials, and we also did not have any inter-row cultivation. The only management operation that we used for the living mulches where we would cut them back to a height that was suitable for their regeneration, which was about 40 to 45 centimeters from the soil surface. Every time they reached a height of about 30 centimeters from the top of the cotton canopy. So we expected that in such a system, the living mulches would provide would provide good weed suppression and soil cover and produce considerable amounts of biomass, and all this without adversely affecting the cotton yield. The results were actually much better than what we expected. We actually saw a positive relationship between cotton yield and living mulch biomass. That's a solid line. And this was confirmed by another positive relationship between cotton yield and living mulch biomass. And in cotton, the increased height of the plants is also, in most cases, it also shows better growth because the increased height also mostly means increased ball formation. So that was a positive result. So 2013 was a relatively wet year, but 2012 was very dry. And when we looked at this year alone, there was a negative correlation between cotton yield and living mulch biomass. And we would see very similar results also in the tomato trial also. Essentially, good soil moisture conditions were essential for success of the living mulch systems. This graph shows the average cotton yield at different levels of the living mulch biomass for different species. And these are the average cotton yields at each level of the biomass, average of all the species at each level. And this is the control, this is the cotton yield from the control. We see that initially there's a decline in cotton yield with the presence of living mulches, and then there is an increase with the increase in living mulch biomass to even above the control. We believe that this is because the living mulches here, which produced less biomass and were less vigorous, in the the weaker living mulch stands were unable to suppress the weeds adequately. And it was the weeds that caused caused reductions in cotton yield here. And this is supported by this graph, which again is similar, except it has weed ground cover on the y-axis and not cotton yield. And we can see here the increased weed presence in the lower biomass, lower living mulch biomass plots, which corresponds to the decrease in cotton yield here. And the inset graph at the top is just to confirm the strong negative relationship that weed pressure had with both living mulch biomass and living mulch cover. So again, we would see such relationships in the tomato trials too. And moving on to the tomato trials, these were conducted in the Homer C. Thompson Vegetable Research Farm at Frevel. And we discussed briefly the different benefits of having living mulches, but there are two main challenges to their adoption. Their competition with the cash crop, which leads to yield losses, and then their unreliable weed control. So when herbicides are used along with living mulches, there's a potential that this combination can complement each other. So the herbicides would assist the living mulches in weed suppression, while at the same time suppressing the vigor of the living mulches itself. So it wouldn't compete with the cash crop as much. And as we have seen before, the living mulches also are capable of contributing towards weed suppression themselves. And so here, there's the potential to decrease herbicide application rates because the living mulches are also contributing towards weed suppression. And this translates into reductions in herbicide input. But for such a system to work, the herbicide must, of course, be registered for use in the crop, and the living mulches must be sensitive to the herbicides used. However, the application rates of the herbicide must be low enough that the living mulches are able to recover. Also, the herbicide applications must be able to target weeds disproportionately more than the living mulches. And since we do not have a lot of herbicides to work with in vegetables, in our trials, this was primarily achieved by the larger size of the living mulches at the time of first herbicide application. So typically, the living mulches would emerge much sooner than the weeds, and they would be about 20 to 25 centimeters tall at the time of weed emergence. So the herbicide application would affect the smaller weeds more than the living mulches. We used two species of living mulches, which we used in the cotton trials also, Cispania and Sun Hemp. However, Cispania did not emerge that well during any of the years that we tested it. So the results that are presented here focus on Sun Hemp alone. There were a couple of reasons why we chose a tomato crop. Tomato can be planted in wide rows, and also tomato has relatively more herbicides that are registered for use in it, so we had more herbicides to work with. We chose four different herbicides, rimsulfuron, fumisafen, metribuzin, and halosulfuron. All of these were applied, all the herbicide treatments were applied post-emergence. We used no pre-emergent applications. And we categorized these herbicides into two types based on the sensitivity of the living mulches to these herbicides. So the type 1 herbicides caused more living mulch injury than type 2 herbicides at the applied rates. And each herbicide treatment consisted of one application each of two different herbicides. So we had four herbicide treatments, and these were used along with the control, which was hand-weeded, weed-free, it had no living mulches, an untreated check, where the living mulches were not treated with any herbicides, and then the weedy check, which had no living mulches or herbicide applications. So this is a brief explanation of the experimental setup. First, the living mulches were planted in the field using a grain drill. And since it's hard to work with, since the stony soils of Cleveland are kind of hard to work with, so that we are able to, we were able to transplant the tomatoes deep enough. We used a tractor to make furrows where the tomato plants would go. So the furrows were about 8 inches deep. And then the tomatoes were hand transplanted. Irrigation was provided whenever required, which was all the time in 2016 and never in 2015. And this is a typical living mulch stand in early August. So again, this was conducted at the Homer C. Thompson Vegetable Research Farm in Freeville, New York. The first trial was in 2014. It was a preliminary trial. And since then, in 2015, we made a few modifications to the treatments, and the 2015 trial was replicated in 2016. The plots were 12 feet by 15 feet, and the tomatoes were planted in rows 4 feet wide. And between two rows of tomatoes, we had three rows of living mulch with a row spacing of 23 centimeters, and it was so the row spacing between the living mulch rows was 23 centimeters, and the distance between the living mulch row and the tomato row on either side was 46 centimeters. Again, the hypothesis was similar. We assumed that the combination of living mulches and herbicides would provide adequate suppression of both weeds and the living mulch, while also providing considerable soil cover and living mulch biomass, and all this without affecting tomato yield. We collected living mulch, weed, tomato, and soil parameters. The living mulch height and ground cover and the weed ground cover, they were measured at four different times during the growing season. The biomass and the density was measured immediately before the beginning of tomato harvest. Also for analysis of the nutrient composition, tomato leaf tissue was sampled at the time of peak tomato flowering. So, coming to yield results. In 2015, the tomato yield from the herbicide treatments did not differ significantly from the control. They were a little lower, but they were not significantly different. But in 2016, the tomato yield from the herbicide treatments were similar to each other, but significantly lower than the tomato yield from the control. The control is here. And as we can see from the different scales on the y-axis, 2015 was not a great year for tomatoes because it was really wet and there was a lot of disease incidents. So under such circumstances, we expected that the presence of the living mulch would make the tomato plants more vulnerable to disease. However, again, in 2015, like in the Cornell trial, we saw a positive relationship between tomato yield and living mulch biomass, which is surprising but good. So any reductions in tomato yield was not caused by the living mulches themselves. During the same year, there was a negative relationship between weed biomass and tomato yield. The significance, it was not truly significant, it was marginally significant with a p-value of 0.07, which is why I have the bar graphs here to show the trend. So the decreasing order of treatments in terms of tomato yield was almost identical to the increasing order of treatments in terms of weed biomass. So clearly, it was probably the weeds that was causing the causing any reductions in tomato yield and not the living mulches itself, which is very similar to what we saw in the cotton trial. Also in 2015, in terms of living mulch biomass, the living mulch biomass from the herbicide treatments were similar to the untreated check, which means that the herbicide treatments did not reduce the living mulch biomass considerably. However, in the weed biomass, even though the weed biomass is not significantly different between treatments, just the drastic numerical differences between weed biomass and the herbicide treatments and the untreated check and the weedy check, so show that the herbicide treatments were able to disproportionately target the weeds and not the living mulches. In both 2015 and 2016, there was no relationship between weed biomass and living mulch biomass, which means that in both years, the herbicide applications were very important for weed control. In 2016, unlike in 2015, there was a negative relationship between tomato yield and the living mulch biomass. 2016 was a very dry year, and it was likely that this was an outcome of competition for water between the living mulch and the tomato crop. And if this were the case, then in 2015, the positive relationship that we saw between tomato yield and the living mulch biomass was most likely because 2015 was a wet year, which did not provoke any competition for water between the living mulch and the tomato crop. In 2016, the living mulches also in an indirect way caused reductions in tomato yield. This graph shows the calcium concentration in leaf tissue with increasing living mulch biomass, and there's a negative correlation. So in plots with vigorous living mulches, the calcium concentration in the leaf tissue is lower. And in dry conditions can reduce the capacity of tomato crops to take in calcium. And so besides the direct competition of the living mulches for water with the living mulch, with the tomato crop, the living mulches also caused calcium deficiency in the tomato crop, which led to yield losses. So in 2014, this graph here shows a relationship between tomato yield and living mulch biomass, which was again negative. Even though the summer of 2014 was not a cold year, it was not dry. So it could not be the competition for water that was causing this relationship. During the same year, there was a positive, this was again surprising, there was a positive relationship between weed pressure and living mulch biomass. So the weed pressure was more in plots with more vigorous living mulches. So again, it was likely that it was the weeds, it was the weed cover that was, weed pressure that was causing the reductions in tomato yield and not the living mulch biomass. And this relationship, this negative relationship between tomato yield and living mulch biomass was most likely because of the positive association of living mulch biomass with weed pressure. And this strong negative correlation between tomato yield and weed cover further confirms this. So the anomalous positive relationship of weed cover with living mulch biomass was most likely because the living mulches were unable to control the weeds adequately by themselves without sufficient assistance from the herbicide applications. So like I mentioned before, the herbicide treatments in 2014 were different from 2015 and 2016. In 2014, the herbicide treatments consisted of two applications of a single herbicide at a fixed rate. So in those plots which received weaker herbicide applications, the herbicides did not affect the living mulches that much. So there was an increase in living mulch biomass, but they also did not affect the weeds that much, and the weed biomass also increased, and this led to decreased tomato yields. However, in case of the stronger herbicide applications, it suppressed the living mulches more, but it also suppressed the weeds more, and it provided better tomato yields. So since this, in 2015, modifications were made to the treatments so that the herbicide applications would target the weeds more effectively and asymmetrically. And in 2015, like we saw, these modifications, along with the lack of competition for water, showed clearly the positive relationship that is possible between living mulches and the cash crop. Very quickly, to talk about the soil cover crop trials. So, not in much detail. It was very similar to the tomato trial, but the plots were smaller. It did not have any cash crops. And we had many more treatments. We tested 12 herbicide combinations. And the idea was also to understand the best herbicide combinations that would be able to target weeds disproportionately more. What would be the best times for application? What would be the best rates and the herbicides themselves? And here, we were also able to test two new herbicides that are not registered for use in tomato, dual magnum and imazathoprim. So we had six herbicides and 12 combinations. And this is just one result that we saw from the soil cover crop trials. So this graph shows, so since we used many different treatments in the soil cover crop trials, we decided to group them into the order of application of the two types of herbicides. So we had earlier grouped the herbicides into two different types. Type 1 herbicide affects the living mulches more. So living mulches are more sensitive to type 1 herbicide over type 2 herbicides. And so here, we group all these herbicides and the treatment combinations into the order of application of the type of herbicide. So here we saw that the first application of a type 1 herbicide caused reductions in the cover crop biomass compared to the first applications of a type 2 herbicide. This was most likely because when a type 1 herbicide, which is a stronger post-emergent herbicide, was applied first, the initial application, which is in late June, the living mulches were still small at that point, and so these stronger herbicide applications affected them more severely, and it also took a longer time. It also, the recovery time was also longer. And during this time, there was an increase in weed pressure, which further suppressed the living mulches. And that was what probably caused the decrease in living mulch biomass here. Whereas it was the opposite in case of the type 2 herbicides, because the first application of a type 2 herbicides means the living mulches had to deal with a weaker herbicide in the first application. In case of the weed biomass, the type 2...
I apologize, I came late, but can you describe what the difference between type 1 and 2 are?
The type 1 herbicides are herbicides that have that are weaker post-emergent herbicides. So they affect the living mulches less. So the living mulches are less sensitive to the type 1 herbicides. And type 2, they're more sensitive to the type 1 herbicides. And the type 1 herbicides are more sensitive. The living mulches are more sensitive to the type 1 herbicides and less sensitive to the type 2 herbicides. So in case of weed biomass, the type 2 plus type 1, the first application of a type 2 herbicide was most effective in weed suppression. And this was likely because during the first application of a type 2 herbicide, which did not affect the living mulches as much, since the living mulches are already larger in size at the time of first application, larger in size than the weeds, the type 2 herbicides did not probably affect the living mulches as much, but affected the smaller weeds much more. And what this provided for the living mulches was the window of low competition during which it could establish well enough to withstand application of a type 2 herbicide, which would again disproportionately target the weeds more because the weeds are smaller in size. And in quick summary, absence of dry conditions might be essential to prevent yield losses in living mulch systems. And herbicide applications might be essential for adequate weed control. Also, in a cropping system, there are many factors that can be manipulated so that herbicide input is reduced and so that the herbicide applications are able to target the weeds disproportionately more. But once these factors are established, it is important that the strength of the herbicide application is based on achieving adequate weed control and not on achieving a target living mulch biomass or living mulch cover, because even vigorous living mulches can be unreliable in the context of crop yield. So, but we did find that the combination of living mulches and herbicides did work well. They suppressed weeds well, they provided good soil cover, they produced considerable amounts of biomass, and they also showed potential in their ability to not affect the crop yield. We were also able to reduce the application rates of the herbicides by up to 75% in metribuzin and 81% in rimsulfuron. However, also from our trials, results which I've not really shown here today, we found that it would be valuable to develop more methods to further reduce the height of the living mulches. And that provides opportunity for future study. With that, I would like to acknowledge the help and support that I've received. At the outset, I would like to thank, I would like to acknowledge my gratitude to Robin Bellander, who took me on as a graduate student. I would like to also thank my graduate committee, Steve Reiners, Tony DiTomaso in Soil and Crop Sciences, and Mike Walter in Biological and Environmental Engineering. My thanks also to the lab and farm crew, Peter, Zwanko, Rebecca, and Robin's lab, and Steve, Rick, and all the other Freeville crew. Also in the Vidarbha project, I would like to acknowledge my gratitude to the faculty and staff at the PDKV University, and all the growers that collaborated with us. And my thanks also to the Northeastern SARE, the TSF, and the Tata Cornell Initiative for their financial support. With that, thank you, and I'll take any questions. Yes. So the question was how these results translate into the real world. So if we conduct similar experiments in different crops using different herbicides and different living mulches, and we are able to create a database of different application rates, different herbicides and living mulches that we can use in different crops in different regions, then we might be able to provide the growers with a ready-to-use package of practices that they can immediately implement, and this would be towards reduction in herbicide input and soil conservation.
Are you in contact with people in the field, like translating this?
A few extension agents. So the question was, am I in contact with people on the field regarding the dissemination of this information? No, not really. There have been a few field days and other presentations that I've been a part of. I've worked with maybe a couple of extension agents in the Cornell Cooperative Extension.
Other questions?
Yes,
so Vinay, it was mountain fresh, the tomato, right?
Yes.
Is that determinate or indeterminate variety, and would that have any effect on the results you may have seen?
So the question was if the tomato variety that we chose, the mountain fresh, if it was determinate, or if so, would that character have influenced the results any? Mountain Fresh was indeed supposed to be a determinate variety, that's why we got it, but it turned out that it wasn't really that determinate. So we ended up harvesting it maybe three times each year. In 2014, this was a really good year, we harvested up to five times.
but I'm not sure if it would have influence the results any, because the sampling that we conducted before the beginning of tomato harvest for the living mulch biomass and the process of tomato harvest too was pretty destructive on the living mulches. So it is unlikely that it would have seen much of an effect moving from the beginning of tomato harvest.
Is this a commercial crop that you're using, the mountain fresh?
It is a commercially grown fresh market tomato crop.
Vinay, this may be a focus for future study, but it would seem that there would be an economic appeal of using a harvestable living mulch like the lab you did in that one experiment, and not using herbicides, so that both the primary crop and the living mulch crop could contribute to the value of the field.
True. So the question was, if we used a marketable living mulch and without herbicides, if that would make the system better. So one of the reasons, at least when we began the living mulch trials, one of the reasons why we chose non-marketable living mulches was because in the cotton cultivation, there was very little residue that was going back into the field. Cotton itself does not produce that much leaf litter, and the stems, which are the woody stems, are taken, removed from the field for use as fuel. So there was very little residue that was going back into the field. And so the idea was to use a living mulch that would stay in the field, that would not be taken out, would not be used for anything else.
To provide more organic matter.
To the soil, yes. That was the primary concern in the trials. And I thought we would like to keep it that way so that there is all the residue goes back into the soil.
So the goal of your research is to get away from the herbicide, because otherwise you're polluting the environment, right?
That is true. The question was if our primary objective is to reduce herbicides, and yes, we were trying to reduce herbicides. Brian?
I'm curious what you think is happening with respect to nitrogen in these systems, because you mentioned that most of these are legumes, so would that be another advantage to add nitrogen through nitrogen fixation instead of relying upon nitrogen inputs, or did you look at that, or do you know others that have looked at that?
So the question was if the nitrogen fixation of the legume living mulches was a consideration in these trials. In the first trial, yes, it was. We didn't have to inoculate it because the inoculant was present in the soil naturally. And it did produce, there was a lot of inoculation, and we believe that there was considerable amounts of nitrogen that was fixed. And even though we did not measure it, that might have helped the cotton crop. But in case of the trials we conducted at Freeville, the living mulches were not inoculated, and we did not see any inoculation there. However, in the idea behind not inoculating it was to make it more competitive in the interwar space with regard to the weeds. However, in 2016, we did have an inoculated strip of sunhill adjacent to the main tomato trial. However, and the inoculation was excellent and the growth was excellent, but what we saw was when you inoculate the sunhill, the tomato yield is horrible. And I think the reason is, and this is visible from the field too, I think the availability of nitrogen makes the living mulches too vigorous. And then you have to, it cannot be controlled with the herbicide rates that we use. And they just get out of control. And the shading is a very important factor in reducing the tomato yields too. But even other than that, just from the increased availability of nitrogen, I think it also made the living mulches more competitive for other nutrients and water, light, and so it wasn't really good on the tomato crop at all.
So what is the natural inoculant?
It's a rhizobia. It's a strain of. So the question was what the natural inoculant is. It's a strain of rhizobium bacteria. Yes, sir.
Vinay, a more basic question. What got you to think about using living mulches that are from subtropical, tropical regions in the Northeast? I mean, what was the rationale for having you, why not use more typical kind of living mulches for our region?
So the question was, what was the rationale behind using tropical living mulches in the tomato trial in the Northeastern United States, and why not use more locally used varieties? So the main reason was we needed to find living mulch that the architecture of the growth was very important, and sun hemp was one that provided it. It was erect. It wasn't creeping, it wasn't pushy, so it would disturb the tomato canopy, the crop canopy less. And we also wanted, we chose tropical mulches because we felt it would be able to better take advantage of the summer climate and grow very quickly and rapidly, produce lots of biomass. And also an important consideration was that being tropical, the chances of it setting seed was very unlikely because it would be killed at the first hint of frost.
How does the tropical varieties relate to the Ithaca climate? Why do you look into that?
So the question is, how does the tropical living mulch varieties translate into the Ithaca climate, and why we use that? So like I mentioned before, the idea was to use living mulches that would be able to take advantage of the summer climate really quickly, and they would have a growth structure that would not disturb the tomato canopy as much. And we also wanted living mulches that would not set seed. And so being tropical, it helps because it dies much before the first frost. And it
so
wouldn't
how
set
long
seed.
Is the growing region in Ithaca?
So the question is, how long is the growing season in Ithaca? It's typically from end of May through end of September.
So is that a short region? Is that a short period of time compared to other regions?
So the question is the growing region in Ithaca shorter compared to other regions? It is, the growing season in Ithaca is shorter compared to the southern parts of the United States, compared to the tropics. But compared to the Northeast, it's not much different.
Vinay, can you see if Geneva has any questions?
Yes, Geneva. Do you have any questions?
I have a question. So, can you tell us when did you turn the living mulch crops in your tomato trial?
So, when did I plant the living mulch crops?
10 minutes.
Oh, okay. So the question was when did we terminate the living mulch crops and living mulches in the tomato trials? We did not actually do any termination operations. Towards the end of the tomato harvest, in most seasons, the cover crop, the living mulches died by themselves because of the cold. And even after the tomato trials, we would leave what was left of the living mulch in the field, and the tomato crop along with the living mulches would be plowed under towards the end of October when they prepare the field for the next year.
So when did they naturally die out? Is it September, late September?
So the question was when they naturally died off, and yes, it was in late September.
Hannah, did you have a question? I couldn't tell.
I was just curious that if this research continues, is there any potential for doing some sort of cost analysis? You mentioned at the beginning that typically living mulches don't have any benefit, but if you're increasing weed suppression and reducing herbicide application, that perhaps that can provide some economic incentive for growers interested in it. I'm just curious if any cost analysis has been done, or
So the question was, have we done any cost analysis on the using a living mulch that has no economic value, and if it has been done before?
Yeah, or if you think about doing it in the future, if anyone is interested.
I'm not really sure. There have been many studies on cost analysis of marketable income crops, especially in the tropics and in from the southern regions of the United States and in Australia too. So there have been a lot of economic analysis on intercropping, multiple cropping, but in case of living mulches itself with no economic value, I'm not familiar with any studies that have gone into the details of the benefits of the living mulch in the subsequent years that would and what effect it would have on the cash crop itself.
Okay, I think we're out of time, but I want to thank Vinay for an excellent presentation. Thank you, Vinay.
This has been a production of Cornell University on the web at cornell.edu.